The Little Old Lady Behaving Badly by Catharina Ingelman-Sundberg, translated from the Swedish by Rod Bradbury and read by Patience Tomlinson. To my listeners in English, all over the world, thank you for your enduring support. Prologue. The little old lady put the bottle of champagne into the fridge. After a bank robbery, it's always nice to celebrate, but of course you have to ensure that the bubbly is properly chilled. Martha Anderson hummed a little to herself while she put out a tray, 5 tall champagne glasses and some light snacks on the kitchen table. Then she went into the bedroom to prepare herself for the coming night's adventures. While she got dressed, she went through the plan in her head one last time. In exactly 2 hours, the League of Pensioners would strike again, and this would be their most advanced crime yet. She picked up the keys from the hall table and went out into the dark. Chapter 1. When the refuse collection lorry stopped outside the bank, nobody reacted. Not even when the suction tube mouthpiece was manoeuvred out and connected to the building's waste disposal system. It was 4:30 in the morning, and none of the people out on the streets of Stockholm at that time of day were interested in rubbish, with the exception of the League of Pensioners. A flash of lightning lit up the sky, and the 5 pensioners looked contentedly at one another. Thunder was just what they were waiting for.
"Right you are," said Martha.
And she glanced up at the large bank palace.
"Banks don't like it when you withdraw money, but now this will really be an eye-opener for them."
She felt the buttons on the control panel for the pneumatic collector and looked out through the windscreen. The collection lorry could manage 10 tons, and what was in the bank vault would easily fit. Now all they had to do was suck it all into the tank.
"Okay, here are your face masks," said Martha,
handing out a bearded Pavarotti to Brains, a grinning Elton John to Rake, and a clean-shaven Brad Pitt mask to Christina's son, Anders.
"Out you get, and good luck."
"What about me?"
Anna-Greta objected, stretching out for the smiling Margaret Thatcher latex mask.
"Oh, yes, of course," mumbled Martha,
and she handed her the mask. The presumptive criminals put on their masks, got out of the lorry and took up position on the street, while Martha and Christina remained sitting inside.
This was it.
Down on the pavement, Brains contentedly patted the pipe leading to the waste disposal system, adjusted his working overalls with the logo "We'll clean you out" across his chest, and walked towards the entrance. The considerably younger Anders, from the same firm, walked after him with 2 wheelie bins, and the others waited a while before they too followed. Rake had his bandana neatly tied around his neck, and his colleague, Anna-Greta, wearing a wide-rimmed felt hat, supported herself with her walking stick for the sake of appearances. It was, for that matter, still a little bent from when she'd taken it with her to the sauna steam room at the Grand Hotel, but it was her favourite walking stick. The friends looked up at the sky. Heavy, dark clouds, flashes of lightning and the first few drops of rain. It looked most promising. A grey rain became all the more noticeable, and the buildings turned into dark shapes in the gloomy light. You could hardly see the figures moving on the street, let alone identify them. That was just what they wanted. Brains punched in the door code and then held open the door for the others in a gentlemanly fashion.
"Don't forget to keep quiet. A few floors up, there are people asleep in their beds," he admonished them.
"Absolutely. We won't make a sound,"
said Anna-Greta with her bellowing voice. As usual, she wasn't wearing her hearing aid. The League of Pensioners quickly slipped in through the door, while Anders, who was wheeling the specially manufactured bins in reinforced, extremely lightweight styrofoam, followed behind them. Martha had insisted on lightweight wheelie bins because the rest of the equipment, the folding ladders, tools and other paraphernalia, was rather heavy. If you were a crook in your 80s, you had to take care not to strain yourself. They didn't care about the bank premises on the ground floor, but took the lift to the bank's staff entrance up on the first floor. The gang had studied a plan of the building and knew that if you were going to get into the vault the usual way, you'd have to force doors that were 2 feet thick. Even the cotter pins were thicker than the biggest telephone poles. So it was better to concentrate on the floor above, which was of pine wood and insulated with plasterboard and chipboard.
"That sort of jerry-built construction can be broken up by sneezing," Martha had said when they planned the coup. "Chipboard and plasterboard! Goodness me, that's junk material!"
As part of their preparations, she'd been inside the bank and discussed some investments, and on those occasions she'd made a point of complimenting the bank officer for the elegant flooring. And then, of course, she had asked how it was constructed and where she could get a similar floor because she wanted one just as fancy for her own flat. Indeed, as with every crime, good planning was of the essence. Brains felt a drop of sweat on his chin. The work overalls were too warm, and wearing a Pavarotti latex mask was admittedly a good way of fooling the police, but it was stickier than the worst toffee. Rake's Elton John disguise didn't seem nearly as uncomfortable, and Anna Greta actually looked perfectly happy as Margaret Thatcher. Even though a former Prime Minister would hardly have gone around in work clothes with the logo "We'll Clean You Out" written on them.
"Here it is."
Brains looked around him, took a deep breath, and quickly picked the lock to the staff entrance. Then he carefully opened the door, advanced a few quick steps to the alarm panel, and short-circuited it. The others followed after him. And once inside the door, they turned on their little diode lamps and let the beam sweep over the room. Dark brick walls, newly laid floor, some bookcases, chairs, and a meeting table in the middle. It looked just like any other workplace does, but this one was right on top of a bank vault with at least 10 million kroner in it. Brains pulled one of the wheelie bins towards him and fished out a compass saw, a drill, a hammer, and some little blue and pink pigs he'd got from Swedbank. They were piggy banks, which preferably should not be shaken, because on this occasion they were filled with explosives and not with coins. Brains, with his many years' experience as an engineer and inventor, had thought that 12-inch firework bombs with black powder ought to make the work a bit easier. And so, without Martha knowing about it, he'd added some extra. In particular, the pink piggy bank had a very potent charge.
"And now the ladders," said Brains,
scratching himself under the Pavarotti beard. Anders lifted them out of bin number two, fumbled a bit in the semi-dark, but finally managed to put the pieces together. After which, Brains took a deep breath and said,
"Right, my friends, now all we have to do is make some holes in the floor."
The drill and compass saw were handed out, and Brains, Rake and Anders set to work. Incidentally, Anders had chosen a Brad Pitt mask because he didn't want to look as old as the others, and now he regretted it. The mask was so tight that he could hardly breathe. In the pale blue beam of the diodes, the men succeeded in drilling several holes and then enlarging them with the compass saw, after which it was time for the piggy banks. Brains was perspiring so much that for a brief moment he worried that he would faint from dehydration because he hadn't brought a water bottle with him. Dehydration in a bank? Who could have thought of that? Martha looked up at the gable building that her disguised friends had entered. Only she and Christina were left in the lorry. Brains was going to give a signal when they'd reached the vault and broken open a hole in the wall containing the shaft to the pneumatic refuse collection system. So Martha and Christina had to be ready to start up the suction pump, and then it was full speed ahead. Martha tried to remember the blueprint of the building. It would take Brains and the others quite a while to make a hole in the floor, and then perhaps another half hour to break through the wall between the vault and the refuse shaft. If they didn't come across any unexpected difficulties, that is. They'd chosen one of Stockholm's very biggest banks, with the most cash. Because nowadays they had to think in terms of giant robberies if they were to raise the necessary money for their charity work. And there ought to be lots of money in this bank vault. In the computer files at the Central Archive, they hadn't been able to access the drawings of the floors above the bank office since they'd been removed for reasons of security. But then Martha had shed lots of tears, and, sobbing, she told them about her important research work on historic buildings. She was writing a book about this palace-like building, and this was her life's work. The head of the archive gave in, and she was given access to some old microfilms of the building. She giggled to herself and ran her fingers over the joystick. What she now didn't know about the storerooms, the stairwell, the refuse shafts, and the electrical wiring wasn't worth knowing. She even knew how thick the walls and floor were. She glanced up at the bank again. Why on earth was it taking such a long time? Nothing could have gone wrong. Could it?
Just look at that! 50 centimetres thick, just like Martha said.
Rake nodded towards the drilled holes in the floor. Brains put the compass saw to one side.
OK, give me the piggy banks.
Here are our savings, said Anna Greta, and she handed them over.
A good job we didn't make a hole in the refuse shaft first. Then there would have been such a stench here, said Rake.
Brains pushed the piggy banks into the holes and withdrew.
Quiet! Put your earplugs in and take cover! He called out,
and he signalled to the others to follow him into the bank director's room, a bit further away. He didn't have a fuse and a firing device, but was going to set everything off electronically.
Earplugs? Have you ever tried putting earplugs in a latex Elton John mask?
Rake muttered.
Another miss,
mumbled Brains, and he shut his eyes and pressed the button. Martha threw an anxious glance at the windows one floor above the bank. Sometimes she could discern a weak strip of light, that was all. Something must have gone wrong.
Christina, wait here. I'll soon be back, she said as she slid down from the seat.
No, stop,
protested her friend, who was wearing male working clothes and a peaked cap pulled down over her brow.
I can't work the suction pump on my own.
But I'll be back in a jiffy. I'll just make sure everything's in order.
Martha stroked her calmingly on the back of her hand.
I need you here for the time being.
Christina gave her an anxious look, and Martha patted her on her cheek too, for good measure. She hoped she would remain calm. Her friend was always worrying unnecessarily.
Back soon,
Martha told her again, and she opened the door and nipped out into the street. She looked around her, couldn't see anybody, walked up to the entrance and punched in the code. Then she went up the stairs and stopped in front of the staff entrance. There was silence. You couldn't even hear Anna Greta's voice from inside. Martha felt the door handle, pressed it down and went in.
Oh my God, what's Pavarotti doing here? Isn't he dead?
Went through her mind, before she remembered that it was Brains's latex mask.
I didn't dare use too much powder. It only went plut,
Brains mumbled.
You said the charge shouldn't be more powerful than a firework,
he added in excuse, and pointed at the floor where you could see that there were burns around the edges of a large hole.
I meant a large firework, said Martha.
Okay then,
retorted Brains, and he fetched some more piggy banks from the bin.
Now you'll see something. Take cover.
If the Pavarotti mask hadn't been so stiff, then you would have been able to see Brain's smile. But the rubber had the same latex smile as before, and nobody noticed Brain's satisfied grin. The seniors withdrew and crouched down behind heavy oak tables and partitions. A few seconds passed, and then there was a huge bang.
Bloody hell!
Coughed a dust-covered Elton John in a Gothenburg accent, when mortar, planks, floor tiles and plaster collapsed in a cloud of dust.
Nice one,
could be heard from Anders in his Brad Pitt mask as he shook some mortar out of his rubber hair and tried to smother a sneeze.
Oh, yes! Oh, that did the job!
Anna Greta neighed so loudly that her Margaret Thatcher mask was about to fall off. Martha didn't say anything. Her heart was thumping away so hard that she could hardly breathe. Brains had promised that he wouldn't use too powerful a charge, but this must have been heard throughout the building.
"We must hurry,"
she managed to say, and she crept up to the edge of the hole. The force of the explosion had been merciless and had ripped open the floor so that now you could see right down into the vault below. And not only that, the security boxes had been damaged too, and the doors were hanging on loose hinges. Paper, jewellery, and even bars.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.